NCTV 45, The Train, anytime on your time.
This program was provided through funding from Cedars Restaurant in Newcastle, Pennsylvania. A special thanks to Cedars, featuring Middle Eastern, Italian, and American cuisine.
Welcome to the Cedar Sports Corner, everybody. I'm Alex Laverson, and as always, I am joined by our producer, Mr. Angelo Parada. And
hello, Mike!
And he's in a good mood, and I'm in a pretty good mood, too. In a cautiously optimistic mood. Both of our teams had success this weekend in college football. Notre Dame beating...
Triple play.
Why don't you elaborate for the rest of our viewers?
I have to give you a triple play.
Okay.
Did I tell you the big game for Notre Dame was going to be Notre Dame-Syracuse?
You know what? You did. And before we went on the air, I gave you credit, and I knew you were going to bring that up. And, you know, I'll give credit where credit is due.
Number two. Did I tell you the Brownies were going to be in second place?
That is true. Yeah, that is true. And, you know, honestly, I wasn't even thinking about that before we started the show.
You're in your Cleveland attire, so I had to tell you that.
I'm not wearing anything Cleveland. But listen, all right, so number three.
Mm-hmm. Okay. LeBron James, did I tell you he was going to be a wah-wah in Los Angeles?
That's kind of a given, though. Yeah, I mean, I think anyone knows he's a wow.
Triple play.
You know, Angelo, but, you know, you had your triple play. I have, I mean, I don't know if I have a really double play because I figured Pitt was going to win this weekend. I figured the Steelers were going to win this weekend. But I did not think the Pitt Panthers were going to completely run all over the Virginia Tech Hokies. And Angelo, the Pitt Panthers on offense had 654 total offensive yards. That is the most for a school. That is a school record. And their running attack, 421 yards rushing, 4 touchdowns, 23 carries. Quadre Olison, 16 rushes, 235 yards. Darren Hall, 7 rushes, 186 yards. Olson with 3 TDs and Hall with 1. That is dominating the run game in college football. And it's like, where has this Pitt team been? Is this the same Pitt team that...
You always run down the hall when you want a Hokie.
And you can always count on these little cute one-liners from our producer, Mr. Angelo Parada. Yeah, Angelo, I'm cautiously optimistic because... I'm optimistic over the fact that Pitt is in sole possession of the ACC Coastal. ESPN says they have a 95% chance of winning. But any Pitt fan will tell you how worried they are about Pitt being Pitt and finding a way to screw this up. I don't think it's going to happen, but there's still a part of me that's like, oh, please don't let this be the same old story.
It's the grotto.
Why don't you elaborate for us? What do you mean by that?
After they went to Notre Dame, they went to the Grotto.
Oh, yeah.
They're in first place.
Well, you know what? It's kind of like the whole thing, like, you know, the sword got sharpened. I know, I'm doing terrible with that analogy.
No,
you know what they're talking about?
It's
like
uniforms.
The gold uniforms.
The old uniforms. They went back to the old uniforms.
Well, you know what? I'm not going to complain. Those are beautiful. And Angelo, but I think the tough out-of-conference schedule, in a way, kind of prepared Pitt. And it kind of, you know, hardened them.
They just play Duquesne next year.
Hey, listen, Duquesne's still doing well. I have no problem with Pitt playing Duquesne. But, Angelo, right now they're 6-4. 5-1 in the Coastal. And it's all momentum. They go up against Wake Forest in Wake Forest and then finish on the road at Miami. Miami's not having a good year. They should, I think, if they're playing the way they are now, they should beat them both. Doesn't mean they will. Anything can happen in college football. But, Angela, what a tremendous story it would be if Pitt can win the ACC Coastal, and what redemption it would be for Pat Narduzzi after all the criticism he's faced. But
here's what you have to say.
Mm-hmm.
A 6-4 Pitt is better than a 7-3 Penn State in the Lions.
Even though Penn State destroyed them 51-6 earlier this year?
Even though, because Penn State, we can't play anybody that's too good.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. When you look at their schedule, there's no toughness there.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I mean, Appalachian State, Kent State, okay, they've struggled. Okay, mm-hmm. Michigan State was a struggle. They got killed by Michigan.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so I'm not seeing anything that says, oh, I'm Penn State and I got a good record.
Well, you know, the Pitt team now, the way Pitt's playing now, this Pitt team might be able to compete with Penn State or even beat them. Especially, you know, last handful.
Let's talk about the problem here.
Okay.
The problem is, if Alabama loses Auburn,
mm-hmm.
do they drop out of the top four?
No, I don't think they will. They should.
No, you don't think they will, but should they?
Well, what's Auburn's ranking right now?
They're somewhere down around Brazil.
Okay, but are they an SEC school? You know how much love they... It's just like there's so much, like...
But here's the
SEC
thing.
SEC love,
if
like...
If Notre Dame or Clemson would lose, boom, they're gone.
Well, yeah, that's... I don't agree with it. You know what I mean? But I feel like Alabama... I feel like schools like in Alabama and Ohio State... not necessarily Ohio State this year, but just like in general. It's like those... I feel like those two schools will always find a way to get a benefit of the doubt to be... You know, in the Final Four.
And should University of Central Florida be number four?
Are they undefeated?
Yes, they are.
Well, I don't see why they shouldn't get a shot. I mean, all of a sudden now, you know, especially that blowout win over Pitt, they look a little better. And, you know, I think Central Florida is a really good team. I still feel like I wish the college football playoff could be expanded to at least 8 teams. But again, listen, I'm so tired of Alabama.
We have to expand to our sponsors.
We got to expand to our sponsors. And when we come back, I'm sure Angela's going to want to talk some Duquesne Duke football. And we'll stick around Pittsburgh football for most of this show, because we got to talk about Steelers victory and, you know, no show Le'Veon Bell. We got a whole lot of things to talk about. But right now, let's take a break and have a word from our sponsors.
This program furnished by the MAD Unit, Mobile Auto Detailing. See Michael Sad at themadunit.com.
Holy snowman, it's the Turf Bar, home of great sandwiches, appetizers, tacos, you name it, they have it at the Turf Bar. It's just the right food you'll enjoy. Those special drinks, they're there too. And get that nice cold beverage, relax, enjoy the Turf Bar. If you ain't there, you should be.
Hello, friends. Pinella Brothers, 1701 Hamilton Street, provided funding for this program. Great food and drink, Pinella Brothers.
Welcome back to the Cedar Sports Corner, everybody.
And how about those Duquesne Dukes?
How about those Duquesne Dukes? And Angela, I'll let you lead the way here. This is your pride and joy. Why don't you fill it? Why don't you fill us in about Duquesne Duke football right now?
You have to be very ecstatic if you're in Duquesne land, because the Duquesne University Dukes football team is just playing some great football. You know, a win this weekend, and they're heading off to the playoffs.
That's good for them.
You know, this is a strength of schedule thing too, because here's what you got to realize: they beat Sacred Heart. They're playing Central Connecticut. Okay, they played Hawaii and didn't look bad. Now that's all the way out there. Lose by 21. I mean, they only lost the other game after that by 1 point. Or the Dukes are staring at a pretty doggone good season. UMass was their first game, which they played up because UMass is D1 now.
Mm-hmm.
And lost that game. So the Dukes are looking pretty awesome.
What's their overall record right now?
Well, they've got they're 7-3, mm-hmm. 4-1, but the 7-3 is all the D1 opponents.
Mm-hmm.
So,
I think that's good for Pittsburgh, the city of Pittsburgh. I'd love to see all local schools do well. Even like YSU, obviously they're not Pittsburgh, but I want to see all local schools do well.
Now, I don't want to, mess anything up here.
Okay.
But don't look over your shoulder, because here come the Duquesne basketball team.
Uh-oh.
They're 2-0.
Mm-hmm.
And that 2-0 basketball team has got the likes of Notre Dame and Pitt on the horizon.
Well, I'll tell you what, if both Pitt and Duquesne remain undefeated by the time they play each other, that's really great for the city of Pittsburgh in basketball. I want to see that. And don't forget, it wasn't that long ago Duquesne beat Pitt.
Yeah. 2 years.
Yeah, that's the city rivalry game, and that's good. That's good for basketball in the city of Pittsburgh, and it's a good thing that it wouldn't just be such a one lopsided rivalry like it used to be under the Dixon days. So when Pitt takes on Duquesne, I would want Duquesne to be undefeated.
I'm telling you, it's going to be interesting.
It'll be very interesting.
Now, sticking with everything else, there's this guy, his name rings a bell.
Oh, isn't he up for the Nobel Peace Prize?
He gave up $14 million. He didn't even give it to charity.
Yeah, listen, the Nobel Peace Prize joke, how long have I been waiting to say that? Not really long, because everyone else has been saying it, but I'm a fan of corny jokes. But anyway, listen, anyone who's watched the show knows that I'm fine without Bell. You know, it's... Man, this dude leaves $14 million on the table. He thinks he's going to get a very big contract over the offseason. He's banking on that. Man, in this league, who's going to want to pay the money he's requesting for a running back that's coming out of his peak, that's on the older size for the age of a running back? That's taking
a year off.
That's one more pot suspension away from his career's being over. I really think him and his agent really messed the situation up. But hey, who knows? Maybe the offseason comes an egg in my face. Maybe he gets that amazing contract. Maybe one franchise out there is stupid enough to do that.
But once again, we prove one thing.
And what is that?
In the American Football Conference, there's still only two teams.
Mm-hmm.
The New England Patriots and the Pittsburgh Steelers.
Yeah, the Patriots lost.
The Patriots are 7-3, 6-2 for Pittsburgh with the tie to Cleveland. Here you have the Bengals bungling. They're 5-4 and looking to lose more.
Yuck.
The Ravens have already set sail for the basement, where they said they're not renewing the coach's contract and they're having a fire sale on everybody else. clears the way for Cleveland to move up the ladder.
Wouldn't that be something? I'm still not
so
going as far as
becomes the wild, or Cleveland becomes the wild card, playing somebody, and once again.
I don't know, man. I'm still not going to go that far. I wouldn't mind seeing it. I'm not saying it couldn't happen. I just don't think. I really don't think it's going to happen. But hey, you've been right lately, so I mean, you know, who am I to say? Listen. Before we get into the Steelers, let's take a break here because I feel like I am so overly optimistic to talk about how the Steelers and Ben Roethlisberger has not just excited fans, not just excited Steeler fans, but has also excited many fantasy owners, such as myself, who had Ben Roethlisberger starting last week.
Oh, boy, who said that?
He's still very hit or miss. Honestly, you know what?
I take Ben no matter what.
You know what? Honestly, Le'Veon Bell owes an apology to fantasy football players. Talk about the most useless number one overall pick ever in the history of fantasy football. Imagine the players that have him. He went number one, I think, in more than half of fantasy football leagues this year. He never played a snap for any owner. Imagine how many teams just got busted right off the bat. But anyway, we'll talk about that more in the third segment. Now, a word from our sponsors.
Today's programming is brought to you by NCTV 45 and NC Radio 450, Newcastle's community television station. This program furnished by Sporting Goods, 23 East Washington Street, Newcastle. Call 724-658-2535. These fine businesses provided funding for this program. Gatherings, Town and Country, and On Target.
And we are back for our third and final segment of the Cedar Sports Corner. And like I said before break, we're going to talk some Steeler football. Man, Ange, wow, what a performance by that Steelers offense. What a performance by Ben Roethlisberger.
I said I'd take Ben any day, anytime, any place you want to give him to me.
Well, it's not like he's put up these points every single game. I mean, there's been weeks.
What do you want off the guy? Jeez.
Well, no, listen, you're overthinking it. I'm not saying he shouldn't give credit where credit is due, but all I've said was that, like, he's very hit or miss, and I feel like I'm not, like, necessarily wrong. But listen, I'm giving him credit, so just relax, okay? And I'm on my phone looking right now at the points he put up for fantasy owners, and I had him in one of my leagues. Man, he got me 63.57 points. Wow. Antonio Brown got me 15 points, a little over 15 points. So, man, that was just a special day for not only Steeler fans, but fantasy owners of those two Steeler players. And like I said before break, Le'Veon Bell owes an apology to his fantasy owners because he literally ruined the seasons of those fantasy owners. Because, man, imagine picking number one overall and you had to wait all this time. Because it's like a snake league. You have a 12-team league, the 12 picks go by, and then you got to wait again for those other 12 picks to go by to get your pick. And only to find out that you picked Le'Veon Bell number one, and he's not there. And you had to wait about, like, what, 24 selections before you could pretty much pick your first player. If I'm a fantasy owner, I'm never touching Le'Veon Bell again, even if he does get a major contract offer from some stupid team in the offseason. I'm never touching him. You never know what's going to happen with him. But, Angelo, Steelers, man, they're on a roll.
Now, the Steelers are good as gold, but I'm worried about one other team.
Okay.
Pittsburgh Penguins.
Okay. Well,
the Pens went on this big losing streak.
Mm-hmm.
Now, they got 17 points, and the top team has 22, and I know that's only 5 points they're out of first place. However, what the hell? Is the Pens getting older?
I'm not looking too much into it. I mean, it's a long season, man. This happened before. I mean, there's been years, like, you know, they start out slow, and they get to, what, the All-Star break or close to it, and they're actually in 10th place, not a playoff contention. But, you know, there was years where, you know, they had to make a coaching change around that time, and boom, you know, they were able to get into playoff contention. Are they going to make a coaching change? Oh, I still think no. I mean, unless they drastically, keep losing. I don't know if that'll happen or not. As Coach Sully, has he earned the right to not have his seat be heated up? Because we know in hockey that everything's tentative with coaching. It's like the coaching lifespan in hockey, it's like you get hired to be fired. You know how fast it is. And no matter what you've done in the past, it's all about what have you done for me lately. So it's like you could have won 4 cups in a row, but it's like if you start to decline or something, oh, you know, let's make a coaching change to revitalize this team. And, you know, in any other sport or fan base, like, oh, that's nuts. That's too reactionary. But in hockey, when you do that, that's usually what fixes the problem.
Now, I don't want to give you a jolt.
Okay.
But here's the two things, and I'm going to do this in date order. If Green Bay doesn't win at Seattle, do that start to roll? Because, you know, it was
maybe
a bad situation with Green Bay losing last week.
True.
And suddenly the grass is going to be greener in other places and not Green Bay.
Mm-hmm.
So I have to wonder, they're playing Seattle. And Green Bay with a 4-4 record, this puts them in a losing position if they lose. And Seattle already 4-5, and the Rams way out in front of everybody at 9-1.
Mm-hmm.
Seattle has to just win to get a wild card. And if Green Bay doesn't win, Estella Vista, baby.
Yeah, so be it. Honestly, I'm just excited about how the Rams are doing. I like the fact that Aaron Donald, who I think is the best defensive player in the NFL, Pitt grad, of course, Pitt alumni, you know, I'm not biased at all, right? I'm glad to see him on a winning team, finally. He deserves to be on a winner.
Now, I think the two big games at Sunday both happen at 1 o'clock.
Mm-hmm.
Tennessee at Indianapolis, which has to be huge because the Colts might be galloping back into the arena.
Mm-hmm.
And then Pittsburgh's at Jacksonville.
That's the one. That's the game I'm really, really invested in. I'm so mad when the Jaguars beat the Steelers out of the playoffs. When they beat the Steelers in the playoffs to, you know, get them out of the postseason. I just want to see the Steelers just destroy them. And, you know, it's like the Jaguars are that one team, even from the AFC Central day, that I always just feel like is, other than the Patriots, they're just always in the way.
Well, here's the thing. If Jaguars lose, they're gone.
Mm-hmm.
Now, Tennessee and Indianapolis, you got 5-4 playing 4-5. And they both got to win to try and keep up with the Texans.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And so I just see that AFC South as being a roll of the dice on is it going to be the Colts, the Titans, or the Texans? You know,
when a lot of interesting football this weekend.
When I look at the AFC North, I think it's the Steelers.
Mm-hmm.
The Browns, the Bengals, and the Ravens. I think the Ravens have sold themselves on going to the last place.
I'm fine with that.
And the Bungles just will buckle them. Their way down to the bottom.
Oh, God, do I hate Cincinnati. Just everything about that team. Yeah, and Marvin Lewis has been there forever. Yeah, I know they made coaching changes, you know, just a few days ago. It's just like Marvin Lewis is just the one guy who will always be there. He's like the figure. I don't know what their thinking is, but whatever. But, Andrew, I think the bottom line is we got a lot of interesting football this weekend, whether it's college and the pros, and I can't wait just to sit at home this weekend and just watch football for both days. Hey, football weather, right? Mm-hmm. But I think that's break. Yeah, I think that's it for our show. I think we covered a lot. I think the theme of the show was watch football this weekend in both pros and college because it's going to be a dandy. And, man, I'm just so cautiously optimistic about Pitt right now.
Go Irish!
And hail to Pitt. And also, make sure to follow Penn State Shenango Basketball. I know you don't like Penn State main campus sports, but Penn State Shenango Basketball, the school that I graduated from my bachelor's degree, the small campus with the big heart, they're the good guys. You got to root for them. So they're finally back. And make sure to follow them. Give them the support. They need you. And that'll be it. Anything else, Angelo?
Go Irish.
Go Irish. Who saw that coming? But you all have a good one, everybody. Thanks for watching.
A special thanks to the YMCA for caring about the Lawrence County community and providing funding for this program.